welcome everybody to our event on Topology meets Physics, Weather and Electrodynamics. Welcome everybody. I'm very happy that the crowd is something we're missing from real world, we don't arrive. And so the first mini course speaker is Cieliebak from the University of Augsburg. He gives a course on the Symplectic aspects of inertia mechanics. And the first talk today is about the free body problem.
Okay. Thanks, first of all, to Lua for organizing this. And second, for everybody in the audience for coming. And as Lua told me, we are still waiting for some group of people coming from IMPA. But I guess they know whatever I'm going to say. Maybe do you all want to move a bit further to the front, then I don't have to shout and I don't need a microphone. Yeah. I think that is fine, but if you just say that. Okay, can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. I mean, I mostly hear this. Okay. I'm very good. Let me start with a little quiz. So who are these guys? You're out.
Copernicus.
Yes.
And?
Yes?
Yeah?
Yes. Not in that order, but. Alright. So this is from Copernicus writing. I will not want to say much about that. This one I want to say a few words about. So this is for me one of the nice stories in the history of physics or the natural sciences, that from the old Greeks times people were expecting the motion of heavenly bodies to take place on spheres. And people like Ptolemaeus went to great lengths of making this agree with observations, modeling all the motions only with circles or spheres, and he even put like circles on top of circles and so on to it. And Kepler, when he started out, was very much attached to that idea. So he also wanted the motion of heavenly bodies to take place on spheres. And moreover, he had a beautiful idea how the arrangement of the different planets in the solar system might be related to some beautiful piece of very classical mechanics, namely the five Platonic solids. And there were six planets, I think, at the time, and then there were these five Platonic solids, and Kepler had the idea of putting concentric spheres starting. Well, I think I can't see it in the middle, but starting from the outside, there's a sphere, then you put a cube inside the sphere, and then you put another cube inside, another sphere inside the cube, just barely touching it, and then you put a tetrahedron inside of that, and you go on with the dodecahedron, I think, and so on. Yeah? And then his hope was that if by doing that, you find certain radii, ratios of radii ratios of distances of the different planets from the Sun, and they match surprisingly well the distance that come out of that model. So he built this model physically, and he loved it. This is a perfect model for the heavenly motions. But then he went to see observations of heavenly bodies by Tycho Brahe, and that changed everything, because then he noticed that the observations just don't fit with that model. And I think it's a nice story, because then he just gave up on that model and came up with a better model, which, as we know today, is also a much, much more correct model. This is another slide I want to show. This is showing two of Kepler's laws in one slide, namely that the planet is moving around the Sun on an ellipse with the Sun in one of the focal points, and the ray between the planet and the Sun is sweeping out equal areas in equal times. This is the now I will switch to the blackboard and turn this off. I will explain on the blackboard, and I'll start by moving forward another century or so to Newton. And Newton single-handedly actually wrote down two fundamental laws of physics. The one this is the notation that we learn in high school. I hope it's the same in Brazil. Yeah. So everybody knows this one. So this is the force, this is the mass, this is the acceleration of the particle upon which the force is acting. And he also had a second law which So, in order for this to be useful, you need to understand how forces are being generated. The second law was this law of gravitation. If we have two planets, say, and then one planet has a mass M1, the other planet has a mass M2, this one is in position U1, this one is position Q2 in three-dimensional space, and then this exerts a force force exerted by the first particle upon the second one. They attract each other with equal forces but in opposite directions, and the force is quantitatively given by M1, M2 times Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1 minus Q2. So this is given the correct direction, and this is the inverse square. So this is the law of gravitation. For physicists among you, you may not be used so much. I'm going to use PQ notations throughout, so from the beginning. So Q will be position of particles, and P will later be momentum. And I'm not going to write arrows all the time. Okay? So all of those are vectors. Just position to like writing. Alright. So now let's look at the n-body problem. So we have positions of those are the positions of say planets that can be other heavenly bodies, and say J goes from 1 to N. So we have capital N particles, and then Qj dot is the velocity, and Qj double dot is the acceleration, which is exactly the A appearing in Newton's law. And we know the forces there, so we can write the equation for the jth particle. So this particle is acted on by all the other particles. And then we have this is the combination of those two laws for a system of n planets, the sun and its planets. Yeah, so, for example, in our solar system, I think the latest count is n is equal to 9, right? Okay. So this in principle determines the motion of the system of n planets under exclusion gravitation. Yeah? So this is the second order ODE. So it has a unique solution determined by its initial conditions. So you prescribe the positions and the velocities of each particle at time zero, and then you can solve this equation. Now, the goal of this lecture is to make a transition between celestial mechanics in the field in which often you just work with the equations as they are, but we'd like to reformulate them in symplectic terms. So let me switch to the Hamiltonian. The advantage is that this first order ODE is of a very special form. Namely, we can write this as dH over dPJ, and the right hand side here as minus dH over dQJ. For the Hamilton function, H of QP is equal to sum J from 1 to N J absolute value square divided by 2. plus sum over all I and j, but with I less than j, of mi mj divided by qi minus qj. So this is exercise two. Show that if you take the partial derivative of h with respect to p, pj, yes, and then you notice that I forgot to put mj here, then you get this one, and if you take the partial derivative with respect to qj, I mean, with respect to qj, only this term matters, and then you get 1 over the absolute value of the q that you can check at the same time. So this is, in fact, the function which is describing the total energy. Where this is the kinetic energy, and this, which I will also sometimes abbreviate as E of Q, so it depends only on the positions Q, this is the potential energy. Okay, let's give those equations a name. So those are Hamilton's equations, and they're equivalent to
maybe just one easy exercise.
If you take a solution of Hamilton's equations, you evaluate the total energy along that solution, then it's constant in time. It's just conservation of energy. From this, you can just.
Trying to understand the behavior of solutions, then some basic questions immediately arise.
And the first basic question is, do solutions exist for all times?
Problems which you usually do not see
for ODEs. Because how can this fail? How can solutions fail to exist for all times? Well, the first thing that can obviously happen in this system is that two of the planets can just collide. Yes? So this can fail.
Non-linear ODE is that solutions can go off to infinity in finite time.
Yeah. And what does it mean, solutions go on Earth to infinity? It would mean that one of the, at least one of the planets is going off to infinity in finite time. So escape of a planet to infinity in finite time. So in both of these questions are subtle, namely about collisions. Well, collisions can obviously happen. Yeah, I mean you just take two bodies and you place them and you don't give them any initial velocity and they will start accelerating towards each other and they will bump into each other. So collisions happen. But the question is how likely are they? If you take the space of all initial conditions, so all positions in momenta, and in that space you ask like there's a certain subset of the phase space of initial conditions which will lead to collisions. So how big is this set? And there is one theorem that I know, it's by Sari from 1977. This might not be the only theorem in this direction, but it's an example of something that people can prove, is that for the four-body problem, set of initial conditions leading to collisions has measure zero. By the way, the four-body problem includes the three-body and two-body problem as well. If you just set one of the masses equal to zero, you can just, So when you prove it for the four-body problem, you have proved it for the three-body problem as well. Yeah. But for more than four planets, we don't know even that the set of initial conditions we need to collisions is of measure zero. So there might be a positive probability that given the initial conditions, you run What about the second one? This took quite a bit longer to be settled, to understand whether this is possible in this concrete system. Of course, you can always fabricate some ODEs which have escaped completely in finite time, but does this specific one have this feature? And the answer is yes. This is due to Jeff Hsia from 1992. So, can this happen? Yes. In the five-body problem. So if you have at least five planets, then you can construct some initial conditions. If you start solving the ODE given these conditions, then after finite time, one of the planets will be thrown off to infinity.
But for up to four, is it easy to prove that
cannot happen? I'm not even sure it's known that for up to four, it does not happen.
For four,
it does. Sorry?
For four, it can also happen.
For four, it can also happen.
That's very easy.
Okay, yes, okay.
For three, it's
impossible. And for three, it's
impossible.
It's impossible.
Yeah.
And
it's
so
not.
It is not, okay. So I should update my reference. Okay. Right. So this is one question you obviously be interested in. The other, I'm not going to say anything more about this. The second one is the question of stability versus chaotic behavior. Let me maybe at this point not say so much about this. So this is roughly the question will our solar system look roughly the same in 1 billion years as it does today, or can it look drastically different? So is the solar system over long times stable in the sense that it will still look roughly the same with the sun in the center and the planets encircling the sun on their elliptical orbits without anything terrible happening? Or is it not true? Or can there, at some moment, can it deviate drastically and, I don't know, maybe go into one of these motions where one of where the planet Earth is finite time ejected from the solar system? Chaotic behavior, I'm going to say a little bit about it tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, what one possible definition of chaos is, and we're going to see that chaotic behavior does happen already in the field.
Now,
one nice thing about the Hamiltonian formulation is that in the Hamiltonian formulation there's a very nice way to talk about conserved quantities. Namely, there is a Poisson bracket on function on phase space. So for, if you take two functions f and g, so body problem, the phase space is the space where you have all the position and all the momenta of all the n particles. So for every particle you have three position and three momenta. You have six quarters for each particle, you have six n. So the six n dimensional linear space. Well, yeah. Of course, one should take out a certain set where two positions for this, it doesn't matter. So, if you have two functions on phase space, then you can define another function by taking the sum over all j, del f over del pj, del g over del qj minus del f over the qj, the g over the ej, like this. And, well, first it's just some definition that defines a new function. And this has some properties which follow immediately from the definition. First of all, it's q-symmetric. Then it's a derivation. F applied to Poisson bracket with g times h is g fh plus h fg, and it satisfies Jacobian identity. of the Hamiltonian system of the Hamiltonian H. So you have a Hamiltonian H, it defines you this Hamiltonian system, you take a solution of those, and now you see how a different function changes and all that one. And now let's do this one computation. So this is the sum over all J, del F over del QJ. Then we have QJ dot, then we can write it plus del F over del PJ, PJ dot. We plug in Hamilton's equations. Where this should be read as the change of the function along the solution of Hamilton's equation is given by the Poisson bracket with the Hamiltonian. And now we see that this function is constant along solutions of the Hamiltonian system if and only if it was its Poisson bracket with the Hamiltonian. So f is a conserved quantity, or that's also called an integral of the motion. If this was not bracket. And conserved quantities are, of course, very useful to understand solutions. If you know some functions on phase states which remain constant on solutions, that helps you solve the system because it helps you reduce the space in which you want to solve the system. So you can reduce dimensions. We'll actually see that using symplectic reduction, that every conserved quantity allows you to reduce the dimension on phase space by 2. Conserved quantities for the n-body problem. Well, the first and obvious conserved quantity which we've seen before is Hamiltonian Poisson commutes itself, which is a formula that becomes a complete triviality just because the Poisson bracket is still symmetric. It's automatically the case, and it says that the Hamiltonian is constant along the solution. So this is conservation. And then let's introduce the total momentum. Capital P is sum J. One n of the momentum. This is the total momentum. And I may not do the computation. You check that, that it was. By the way, if I'm going too fast and slow, you can let me know. If I should any computation, but I think this is you're just plugging in the equation. So this is conservation of momentum, which means that so this allows us to bring the n-body problem to more specific form. Namely, we can split off the motion of the center of mass. So let me just not do the computation, but discuss some consequences. Let's define capital Q to be the sum Mj Qj divided by capital M, where capital M is the total mass, and then this is the center of mass. And you check that Q dot is equal to some Mj Qj dot divided by M, which is this is just Pj, so this is just the total momentum, which is constant. Was the conserved quantity, so the center of mass is moving with constant velocity. So this is linear motion. So you have this n-body system. And the center of mass is just moving with constant velocity through space, while the shape and the positions relative to each other will change over time. So now one can simplify the original system by going to relative coordinates relative to the center of mass. So we can introduce coordinates in which I do it right by Qj tilde is Qj minus the center of mass, and then Pj tilde is Mj Qj tilde dot, which is Pj minus. Coordinates and momenta relative to the center of mass, and then you can check that they satisfy again the same Hamiltonian system with the same Hamiltonian if you just apply it to the relative motion, and the relations between the Hamiltonian applied to QP and to the relative motion is, if you compute H of QP, is P, the total angular momentum divided by 2m plus H of. So this is the total energy, this is the kinetic energy of the center of mass moving with constant velocity, and this is the energy of the relative motion. So after switching to these new coordinates and dropping the tilde, may assume without loss of generality that we just consider the motion of the relative coordinates. So we may assume that the center of mass is staying fixed at the origin. So the center of mass Q, which is the sum of the J divided by M is equal to zero, and the total angular momentum goes to zero. So we may switch to the system of the relative motion, because all the interesting stuff is just happening at the moment. Now, third quantity which is going to play a big role is angular momentum. Each of its components is a function. Each function for some commutes with it. So all three components of the vector are constant in time, which means that the whole vector is constant. Okay, so this is how this is to be understood, and likewise here, because this is also a vector in R3. It should be viewed as a function on the phase space, which takes values in R3, and this means that every component also commutes with every component. And let me not do computation, but rather mention Noether's theorem. Noether was a German mathematician in the early 20th century. Mathematician and physicist, I would say. Would you agree? Who realized that there is a systematic way of generating all these conserved quantities from symmetries of the system. So the slogan is that symmetries of a Hamiltonian system give rise to conserved quantities. Okay. So, more precisely, what do we mean by symmetries? I'm not going to state it in the most general form. In fact, this Noether theorem plays a very important role in, I think, all branches of physics. It comes up in high energy theories, and all over the place there is conserved quantities arising from symmetries of the system via Noether theory. But here in the most classical setting, let me just say the special case, which is enough to generate those conserved quantities. So suppose we have S. every real number, we associate some transformation, and this transformation should be in the isometries of r to the 3n. So this is where the position variables. Yeah. So I'm going to be more specific. So suppose we have such a family of transformations, which should be a one-parameter group. So it satisfies the group flow with respect to addition of real numbers and propagation of one parameter group of symmetries. So those are the symmetries on the left hand side. Of symmetries. What do I mean by being symmetries of the system? They should. Symmetries means that. Let's specialize to a Hamiltonian, which is of the form, well, okay, let me just write it like, form it like this, up to some masses here. It has roughly and this shape, it's a kinetic energy plus potential energy. I'm dropping some masses here, yeah, which I could really so then being isometries makes them be compatible with this kinetic energy part. But we also needed to preserve the potential energy part, namely V of G S of Q should be V of Q. So the kinetic energy is not changing under this compression. So they are really the symmetry of the potential energy. Then, so this is the assumption, and then the following function f of qp is the inner product of p with the following quantity. We take d over ds at s equals 0 of gs of q. So what is happening here? We take some point q, then we have, if we apply gs of q and we let s vary, we get some path. Then we take the derivative of that path here. That gives us a tangent vector in the position space, and we apply we take the scalar product with the momentum vector, which is also a vector in R. We take the scalar product, so this one is a conserved quantity. Who knows this? So who has not seen that before? Okay, should I prove it? Yeah, now maybe. Okay, let's try to use a computation. So we want to compute I could either compute the Poisson bracket with the Hamiltonian, or I compute the time derivative. I mean, it's equivalent, as we know. Let me compute the time derivative. D. I think I need. We get one term with p dot, the second term just stays. And we get the second term, which is P, and then we get now we need to take derivative of this guy, so we take the derivative of GS, we take its Jacobi matrix at the point Q, and we apply it to Q dot. Okay, and I want to show that both terms are in fact zero. So let's see this. Over dq, now if h has this form, it's actually just dv over dq, or in other words, the gradient of v from Hamilton's equation. Now this, by the chain rule, I can write as d over ds is equal to 0 of v of that is zero because this one is independent of S by assumption. Yeah. So now this guy. Now we insert Q dot from Hamilton's equations. So Q dot is 1 over M times P, let me assume masses are. Okay, I say, oh, in this Hamiltonian, there's no masses anyway. This Hamilton equation will just say Q of P because I normalize the masses to be 1. And now let me pull this out, the d over ds. And let's look at this expression. And now you see why I was assuming that the GS are isometries. GS being isometries means that they are this matrix is Q-symmetric. Because the differential of GS lives in the orthogonal group, and if I have a path in the orthogonal group and I take the derivative at the identity, then I'm living in the V-algebra of the orthogonal group, which is the Q-symmetric matrix. And if I'm applying it to the same vector on both sides, I get zero. Assumption that this is the assumption. So, and now let me continue writing here. So over there. And examples. Second example was linear momentum. This arises from the transformation GS of QJ. So now Q is a vector which has many components. QJ is the position of the J particle. We're making the n-body problem. is Qj plus s times the unit vector, say in the first coordinate direction. And you do the same for all j. This gives us a transformation. Now this is a symmetry because if you translate the position of the j, of the I and j particle by the same vector, then their distance doesn't change. And the potential was given just by the inverses of the distances between the planets. So the distances don't change if you translation. Now, of course, translation of isometries, they leave the potential invariant. And this, if you write down this quantity, I will not do this computation. If you write down this quantity in Noether theorem, you see that this precisely becomes the linear. And the third example is angular momentum. Well, it's very similar. Now you're rotating all the positions by the same rotation. And so you're picking some origin and you're rotating. You're rotating them, then also their distance will not change. Will also be symmetries of the system. So rotations of Qj for all j. I mean, I'm applying the same rotation to all the particles. Yeah? Then this will be a symmetry. Then the corresponding conserved quantity is the angular momentum. Actually a pleasant computation, yeah? It's a nice computation with 3x3 matrices. You write a rotation matrix around the z-axis and then you take its derivative and you will see a cross product come up. I think you can do it. So what about the first one? The conservation of energy, that doesn't quite fit into this framework. But of course, once you have a nice principle like Noether's theorem, you want everything to fit into that principle. So you can make it fit into that principle by brute force. But I never found this particularly illuminating. But you can fit it. So conservation of energy, also can be deduced from some variant of Noether's theorem when you apply it to extended phase space. So you take the usual phase space with the coordinates and the momenta, and then you multiply by R2, where here you have the time and energy as another dual pair of coordinate and conjugated momentum, and then you can write a Hamiltonian there on this extended phase space, and which has a symmetry by translating in time. And that is because our original Hamiltonian is time independent because it's autonomous. So on the extended phase space, you have a Hamiltonian which becomes invariant under time translation. You apply Noether theorem there and you deduce conservation of energy. Yeah. But I think conservation of energy is so much easier that it's kind of ridiculous to build up a complicated extended phase space in order to apply Noether theorem. But if you wish, you can make it fit into that framework.
Okay, I think this is maybe a good place to stop. My time is over. Thank you for your attention. Now we have a break and coffee.
yes, yes, yes. Oh, oh, yes. The statement is this one. Okay, so so everything else was set up and definition, but the statement is that is a conserved quantity.
Okay.
And I did not. Yeah, I mean I did
prove
it. So it's, you just check it's time constant along the solution. Yes, that is the statement.
No question.
How do you come up with Hamilton's equations?
How do you come up with
Hamilton's equations? Because I mean, you haven't said any functions. You know that your system preserves the energy. So your solution, so your proportion of your system has to be by the surface.
Anyway, it's not Hamilton, but Lagrange who came up with the, with Hamilton's equations. But I don't know how you get this idea. It's, I mean, maybe they came at it through variational principle, but I'm not sure.
Yeah,
because I think historically it might be that there was the Lagrange formalism.
Yeah.
Well, first there was Newton's equation, but then you can derive it from a variational principle. Using the Lagrange function, and then you can transform that into an Hamilton. So, I mean, that would be one way you could get it, but I am not sure that this is how it went into
Lagrange.
Okay.
Lagrange?
Yes.
Awesome.
I don't know.
Okay, further questions? Thank you.